everybody. It's me, your good buddy Thorn. Today, myself and our good friend Manny are going to talk about the throat defenses and the arm defenses and try to wrap up this whole heavy infantry impression. Are you ready? Let's go. Where we last wrapped up, we'd kind of finished up with the body, and we started talking about the arms. Well, we started talking about some of the throat, okay? And there's a few pieces that we want to talk about before we go on to the arms. The arms are going to take us a little bit, because I do have a lot I want to show you. So, let's get right into the neck defenses. The first one you're going to see is already on, man. Right? It's that chainmail throat protection. As you can see, it's hanging down low enough. It's going to protect his throat. And you've seen it on me, and now you've seen Manuel here wearing most of the kit. That throat defense is going to protect any glances coming in off the armor and into the throat. In real combat, that's going to stop a blade slicing into your throat. You're still going to take the blunt force trauma. That's why it's lined with heavy leather and then behind the padding. In LARPing, it should also protect a little bit of your throat, your trachea down. Let me show you what I'm talking about with a thrust, okay? Let me grab my good old handy dandy Ragnar sword, right? Now, if we're talking thrusting to the chest, which a lot of LARPs don't allow, but it does hit this and glance off into this, it will protect the throat. Even if Manny turns his head down to protect his throat, there's still a gap in that armor. And that's what's to protect that thrusting into there. Now, like I said, accidents happen in LARPs. We're not supposed to aim for the throat, but Murphy's Law, crap happens. Or shit happens. Let's go with shit. This is PG-13, right? Sure, why not? So, throat defenses for chain did protect that a lot of movement. A couple other defenses that we see is that plate gorge. Okay, I'm wearing a different style body armor. This is a little later period. It kind of goes better with the Empire State Troops. And as you can see, this is fairly high up. But what this gorge normally did was to add a little bit more protection to the throat, and sometimes it was laced in to offer that better protection for the neck. And as you can see here, it does do that. It offers that secondary protection. Now, this is Epic Armory, one of my standard gorgets that I use all the time. I'll use this with the chainmail because it does provide points for the pauldrons. Now, with the man he was wearing this, let's take the front off. So if Manny was wearing this, instead of, well, hold on. Manny, we got to borrow your helmet. Okay. Oh, take the chest strap off, Sam. There we go. Now, you can see this is high enough up on the neck, and this could be underneath or over, and at this point it's over, but if it's underneath it, your blade's not going to be able to slip, and once again, live steel, your blade's not going to be able to slip underneath and slide up into it, okay? But let's take that off for the moment. And the other reason I decided to put all the heavy armor on Manny is my squire's not up here this weekend, and so it's just me and me trying to put my armor on me and doing all this takes forever. So this plate defense comes up high enough and should lace into the body armor. Okay, this provides enough extra protection to collarbones, upper chest, not so much the throat, but also the shoulders. And once again, it does tie into the pauldrons. And the reason I'm probably not going to wear this with this is my heraldry is high enough up that I don't want it covered. And that's really the only reason. Epic Armory makes these. They're fairly well made. I've had this for about, I don't know, maybe 6 or 7 years. I've used it quite a bit. It is riveted on fairly well. In fact, all my Epic Armory stuff, I've only lost about 2 rivets the entire time I've had any of my stuff. And one was this pauldron, which I'm changing out. And because of the way you move your arms, that rivet gets used a lot, that attachment point. And it did come off. Oh, well, you know. So, 5 minutes with a hammer and a brass rivet, and it's back on there, no problem. Now, there's a couple other ones that we want to take a look at. Well, one more specifically that I want to take a look at. And right, this is Epic Armory's articulated beaver. And I really do like this piece. It kind of goes a later time period into, let's say, War of the Roses type, the 1460s, 50s. It's a little later, but that's fine when we're talking about this. This has a articulated lower or upper layer. And the only thing that I don't like about this, and I've talked to Patrick about it, and some of these did get away without them getting it fixed. Unless you have a very small neck, that strap's just not going to work. So pop this rivet out, this one right here, replace the strap with one about, that much longer, and this will be fine. Now, like I was saying prior, this would be laced into the breastplate. And Manny's breastplate doesn't have that reinforcement point because this is not for this. But, Manuel, can we bother you for just a second? So as you can see, with a little bit more shaping, this will fit in very close to his neck. Now, this does restrict some of the neck movement, but the protection it offers you for the upper body or for the upper chest, some of the shoulder blades, the neck and the jaw, which is definitely a target in combat, is well worth it. So let's get this attached and we'll take
okay.
Now you can see this does, I've had to attach it with this red ribbon because, like I said, Epic Armory, some of their products came out with very, very short straps, and it's just not cutting it. So I had to attach it with this ribbon. For a later period plate, this is perfect. This is absolutely perfect. It does sit up very high. So unless you really want restricted head movement, it's probably not for you. However, it does offer a lot of body protection. Now with this articulation, once this snaps up, it offers very good protection to the lower jaw and almost up to the cheekbone. Because once again, any blows coming in are going to hit this and glance away. Okay. Now, why was this so effective as armor? Well, let's put the helmet on that goes with this, and I think we're going to find out. Okay. Now, normally, this sort of armor, the Beaver or the Beaver, was worn with a sleigh, either one of several different types of sleighs. This one being a hinged sleigh with a front visor. This is an Epic Armory sleigh. Really nice stuff. Really nice stuff. And like all my gear, I painted it and modified it. So it comes in a blackened, just like the rest of the armor, but I painted it this nice red. Now, what makes this effective is, in combat, majority of the time, you're going to have your visor up so you can see and have good head movement. But when you start moving into the front lines for combat, the visor comes down. Now, this being a Well, being a not real helmet, but for LARP, the vision is much bigger. The vision slot is way bigger. It's still less than an inch, but it's still pretty good size. Plus, you've got good breath. Now, in addition to the Soleil, once you rise this up, this offers almost total protection for the soldier. You've got lower protection, you've got upper protection. You can still raise the visor, even with that up, and it still provides pretty good protection. Once you drop the visor down, although this helmet doesn't really fit Manuel that well, it does provide overall excellent protection. Now, when I say this particular visor is LARP and not real, let me show you a historically accurate Soleil, and we'll really get a look at what it takes, what the difference is, okay?
Okay.
Here is a more historically accurate Soleil. It's not really that much different. It does not have an articulated tail, but it's basically the same configuration. It's got a single-piece helmet with a visor. Well, let's drop that visor and see the main difference, okay? Alright. Now you can see that vision slit is pretty damn small. You can get a blade through it, but it's a pain in the ass. Now, with the bevour up, that's almost total armor protection for the head. It is a fantastic weapons combination. It does restrict head movement. It does restrict vision. But when you need to, you pop the visor up and you can see pretty well. Why was the damn visor vision slot that small? Let me show you. Now, let's imagine our good friend Manny's on the battlefield, the real battlefield. And for some reason, I've gotten up this close to him and have bound his arms or put him in a bind so that he can't use his weapon or shield on me. And somehow I was able to pull my nice dagger out, and I'm trying to stick it in his eye, and it don't work. Now I might be able to get his throat, I might be able to get him this way, but I'm not going to be able to poke him in the eye very well. And that's kind of the reason why the vision slot's the way it is. Okay. That kind of wraps it up for the neck defenses. The next little piece of this is going to be totally on the arms. All right. Give me a second. All right. Now, the last piece of the heavy infantry that we're really going to talk about is going to be the various arms defenses. And we have quite a bit to talk about. So, and you've seen parts of this in various videos, but I really want to talk about various elements you can make, or that you can put together to make up your arm defense. Now, on the right side of Manny here, I've got your pauldron, your upper lames, a one-piece arm that includes upper van brace, articulated elbow, and then lower full am brace. And let's take a look at that and see what it really looks like, okay? Okay, when we're talking armor, I just want to be clear. This is the pauldron, the azacus. This is the upper lames, or the lames of the pauldron. Underneath here is the upper van brace, the articulated elbow, and then the lower van brace. And this is a one-piece set. Now, the pauldron is normally pointed into either the breastplate or the upper armor or the gambeson. This is actually strapped to it with leather straps, and that's something that Epic Armory does, and that's fine. Is it historically accurate? Well, sort of, but it works pretty well and it's fairly straightforward. Now, this upper lame might not be on here on all armor. It is on this one and provides pretty good protection all the way down to the elbow. So almost, we don't need that upper van brace on this particular arm. Now, here's the other side, and you can see where that upper lame lashes into, or in this particular piece, straps into that gambeson and provides protection for the outside of the bicep and the back of the bicep. It doesn't provide a lot of protection for the inside of the bicep, but that is covered by the voiter and by these upper lames. Also by the biezagu. The biezagu is meant to deflect a blade away from this very sensitive spot into the main part of the body armor or off into the upper lames. Okay? So, getting back to this, you've got your upper van brace, your articulated elbow. Now, this is a single elbow piece with an outer guard with two lames on each side. Lame, 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 and then your lower van brace. This is a very nice epic armory piece. I really like it. It has very good articulation points. It has nice elbow protection, and this particular elbow protection is for this. Okay? Now, let me grab my sword. If I'm taking a swing at our good friend Manuel, and I bring in to aim at this elbow, it is going to hit that elbow guard and protect that elbow, just like the lame is going to protect the upper arm. It's very hard for me to get to this piece, and that is why we have that chainmail voider right there. So when that blade strike comes in, it hits that and stops. Okay? Same with the van brace on both sides. It protects the inside of the arm, protects the outside of the arm, and the back of the arm. Very nice for what we are trying to do. So, if you will hold this for me, Manny, thank you. This van brace straps on the upper bicep, straps at the elbow for the elbow, and straps on the lower arm for that, and it's fully enclosed. The only thing that's not that great about this is a very small lower arm. It's okay. It actually fits me if I'm not wearing any padding. But that's why you have to spend the big bucks and get fitted armor, kids. But a nice piece. Very nice piece. And it goes overall well with this assembly, doesn't it? It looks very nice. Okay. Now, some of the other pieces that we haven't really talked about that you could go with. Here's a floating elbow, also by Epic Armory. It is the single piece elbow with double lames. Now that's all there is to this. It either points into your gambeson or straps onto your gambeson and provides the exact same protection level as this piece right here. Now that would leave your lower arm empty or exposed. And you really want to have that protected somehow. And there's a few things that we've already taken a look at that you could use. This is Epic Armory. It's very nice. It provides excellent protection for the elbow. And with minor work on this jacket, these will probably be laced to it and then strapped at the elbow. Very nice piece. So, but for your lower arms, we've already looked at three different variations of the lower arm defense. We've looked at the Ragnar bracers, which cover that whole area as well. We've looked at these, which protect from the elbow all the way down and cover the back of the hand, and are probably going to be my primary lower arm defenses for the Grand Battle. Or a simple bracer strap on that covers that whole section too. So there's a lot of variations that you can do for this arm armor. And so I wanted to show you all these things. Now this is also Epic Armory. And it is actually the set that goes with the rest of this armor. Okay? Now, to show you how those would work on this armor, let's turn Manny around, take a look at the other side, okay? All right, now we're on the other side, okay? So this Bulgurian, I'm still working on some of the paint job. Got to replace that rivet, that's why it looks the way it does. But we still have the Bulgurian and the upper lames. Now, we're using the floating elbows, strapped three places. We could point this on to this gambeson because this is made to be that way, but we just strapped it on. And then we have the lower bracer for that arm. And it provides almost the same amount of protection as we do for the full arm. And it is another way that you can build your armor and provide you the protection you need. Now, if this is your shield arm and you don't need that armor, you could drop this stuff off and it'd be perfectly protected with your shield. So, that pretty much wraps up the arms that I wanted to talk about. Now, if you just give me a second, I'm going to get Manny around to the front and we can take a look at the overall picture one more time, okay? All right. Now, we're pretty much done looking at the heavy infantry, but I wanted to show you this last little image of Manny here carrying the big tower shield. How much protection do you get from a tower shield? And this is basically where his hand is, so that's not even raised up for his protection. Now, imagine once he raises the shield up and brings it forward, how much protection that's going to afford. Okay? With this heavy infantry outfit, you can work in the shield wall fairly easily. It's going to be hot, it's going to be heavier than the chain that I'll probably be wearing, or the mail that I'll probably be wearing in the spear and front ranks, but this is definitely an option. This gives you a good amount of protection. No matter where you try to hit him, he is armored heavily. Now, we didn't touch on the legs because I got a couple different pieces for that too. Now, let's take a look at it. Before or after, well, let's just take a look at it.
All right.
Now, with the Talbert Pearl back, you can see the leg defenses, and we do have the leg defenses on. You can see this gap in the armor, which I'll probably put a chainmail skirt, like I showed you, that covers this part right here. And that will provide even more protection. But now he is plated down all the way down to the knee. And if you wanted to, you could wear a greave on that bottom leg, like we've talked about. But, all right, here's the heavy infantry. Probably the next thing we're going to talk about is using this shield and our equipment in the battle line. And we'll start talking a little bit more of combat tactics and what we want to build our impression to. We're pretty much done with the heavy infantry. I'm going to try to get some video outside of me in this. It might be a week or two because I got to wait for my other guys to come up to get some filming done. But that's kind of what we're looking at. We've done the medium infantry. We've done the heavy infantry. What's next? You know what? Maybe archery. Maybe we should look at an archer's outfit. Well, anyway, that's enough for today. We'll see you later.